Lightning talks. There's also one more lightning talk slot scheduled at 1:30 today, same room. If you want to speak or hear other people speak, so please do come back during 1:30. On the schedule, it says it's a talk by Tathagat Varma, but he's stuck somewhere in Guatemala and can't make it to this place in time. Okay, so that's why we are gonna reschedule that as a series of lightning talks. Today, we'll take three slots. One has already been requested by ZBA or something like that. So if two people who want to do lightning talks can just show up, like first one, two ladies to go, we'll put you in the next slot that happens at 1:30. So the rules are simple. You get to speak for 5 minutes. You can use slides or not, your choice. And after 5 minutes, I'm gonna stop you from speaking. So if you're in the middle of the sentence, you have to stop, okay? So use the speaker or not, or use the screen or not, your choice.
Good afternoon, everybody. So we have done with a couple of activities. So my lightning talk is also, we'll start with the activity. So before that, I am Ramya from Software AG, from Bangalore. Let's do a small activity. Just start listing out the numbers from one mentally. Stop when I say so. Start. Stop. You have to remember the number at which you stopped. Now start listing out the alphabets from A. And stop when I say so. Start. Stop. Again, you have to remember the alphabet at which you stop. Now, think of some five-lettered words. The only condition is you should not repeat the words. Some five-lettered words, randomly. Start. Stop it. Okay. Now, again, list down the numbers from where you stopped before. Start. Stop. And same with the alphabets, where you stopped before. Now again, start from there. Stop. And some other five-lettered words which you did not think of then. Start. Stop. So how was this exercise? Lot of context switching, right? So I think typically all of us go through this context switching every day in our organization day-to-day work, isn't it? So I'm going to precisely talk about how we handle context switching in agile environment. So that's what I'm going to talk about it today. And context switching is known to reduce the performance and focus, but it is an inevitable waste. Do you agree? We cannot avoid it. And especially the switching is more when the same development team has to work on the support and maintenance as well. So I work for a team which handles 8 products, and out of which 8 products, 1 or 2 are always in the active lifecycle development, and some 3 to 4 products are high in support and maintenance. And to add more fuel to the fire, these 8 products are split between 2 product managers. You can imagine how it would be. So how do we handle context switching in my team? The first thing is, we always take the features from a single backlog, and we make sure that the priorities are set and accepted by both the PMs. That's the first task. And the second thing, we always take a single user story at a time, and then we try to cover all the tasks in that user story. Third thing, all of us work in the same user story. This has a lot of benefits. One is, it always helps in keeping the team in the same knowledge base. There's no knowledge gap. If one team member is not available also, there is no delay. And always we have, since we take only one story at a time, there's limited work in progress, and at the end of the sprint, we have some set of completed tasks. Though it might be small, there is something deliverable. That's the biggest advantage. And we also allot some time for support issues or some interruptions. We always have some interruptions, some admin work, some activities, some meetings. So we all allot time for that as well. And my team, it likes the idea of using sticky notes. So we physically feel like moving the task from in progress to do and then to done, it gives a lot of satisfaction. If you have not tried, try it once. It's very effective. We are really feel like we are empowered. We just pull the sticky notes from one column to another. So this is to motivate the team and to make the team less stressed out and be more productive and innovative. I'm sure there are other ways to handle context switching in other organizations as well. I'd be interested to know if there are more innovative ways to handle this. Thank you. typically 5, and one person is in a remote location. Thank you.
Alpana, I work for a company called Amadeus. It is a company that works in the travel domain, and we are a competitor of Sabre for the folks who are not very familiar with Amadeus as a company. A little bit about myself. My primary job at Amadeus is to lead the agile transformation efforts. So this is something that I am doing not just for Bangalore, but rather for APAC. And I wanted to sort of talk about a retrospective on our transformation. So meaning that what were the things we did right, what most companies might run into. And I'm going to talk about it with the Indian context, because Agile is not something that I see as an easy transition in India in the context of, where we have hierarchies are very strongly dinned into our system, and empowerment is not the most natural thing. Some things I would like to talk about is some of the popular sort of misconceptions and misunderstood terms from Agile. Empowerment. So I frequently coach and train teams, and will have a follow-up with management who says, what are you telling these guys? I mean, they want to suddenly run off loose and do everything but on their own. And that's absolutely not what empowerment really means. And there is a tendency to sort of literally translate or interpret the words as they mean. And some things we frequently run into is that we see teams that are more eager to do transformation than their upper management may like. And some things that I would, and I also do, is at the same time, I try to coach the management layer on what to expect from these agile teams. So I don't know if a lot of you may run into those sort of roadblocks in your agile transformations. And we heard a lot of stories in the last 2 days, from Nokia and from other companies in their agile transformations. So some things that I wanted to highlight is what to avoid when trying to go agile. So one thing that I see is teams will sometimes put together like focus groups, quality initiatives to improve something. And these are, external teams to the Scrum teams. So all of a sudden, it kind of puts the onus on some other party for managing the quality, which I think is sort of counterproductive or defeats the purpose of developing these cross-functional teams, where you want everybody to be self-organized, self-disciplined, and self-aware of concepts like quality and things like that. Other things that I see is sometimes too much of process-orientedness, in the eagerness to do Scrum the right way. I see people sometimes doing minutes of their stand-ups, and I go, okay, that was not the intent of, the point of getting everybody in the same room is so that you don't have to go away and look at a document to see what you talked about. So things like that. And the other thing is, sometimes it's simply without having the phobia or the process wrapper of Agile and Scrum and Kanban or whatever, if you see a team that is really doing all the right things, just let them work together and get the thing done. I mean, this is somewhat extreme, but what it allows teams to do is to exploit their own talents to the max, instead of having a formal training or some sort of a process wrapper around it. The other things that I would like to see teams avoid is to map waterfall to Agile, meaning that you see a traditional project manager and you say, so who is the project manager of the Scrum team? And there isn't one. So the team is what owns the delivery, owns the quality, owns everything. Or sometimes we have told product owners, that you come closest to the project manager because you own the roadmap, you own the product. And it's a lot of tutoring and coaching, and it's a lot of teams holding everybody accountable in their roles, rather than one person overseeing and blessing everything from the outside, from say a management or a coach angle. And the last thing that I will say that maybe most management and companies run into is putting everything on that coach to say, I have a team that's doing all the wrong things, now you go fix it. And it never works that way. You will never find an external entity or some coach you know, who has about 30, 40 years of experience come and fix something that you cannot fix yourself. So I would love for management and teams and to put that ultimate faith in your own guys. Look inside. You have all the talent, you have all the raw materials you need, and often it's just putting those people together and, you know, seeing the magic happen. So so avoid looking outside for answers, and most of the times it's what you can do yourself. Thank you.
So looks like we have one more slot. If you want to come up, Unnat.
Hi everyone, my name is Unnat Gupta. I work as a business analyst with ThoughtWorks. Has anyone heard the name WebVAN? Anyone aware of this term? Jason, yes? No one else? Okay, does everyone remember 2000-2001.com crash? This was supposed to be the biggest flop of that 2000-2001 crash because of the money involved, over $1 billion. Now, what happened is, 97-98, the person, Louis Borders, he came up with an idea that you can order your groceries online and they will be delivered to your location in 30 minutes. Now, whether Domino's came up with that idea first of 30 minutes or WebVAN, I don't know. For next 2.5 years, he hired 80 developers, people from Goldman Sachs, Boston Consulting to manage everything. They launched in 2000-2001 around. Within first month, they had 25% of the customers which they were estimating, and still their supply chain was not able to cope up with it. Any guesses why that happened? So if you're buying your groceries, what is the time of the day when you would like them to be delivered? Either morning or in the evening. You don't want them to be delivered during your office hours. So everyone was ordering, but in the evenings. And their supply chain was met to take care of things throughout the day and not just in the evening. So the load was too good for them. So what could they have done? It's not a big problem to solve. They could have solved it easily. But what could they have done so that they have never faced this kind of thing? That's what I'm gonna talk about in next 2-2.5 minutes. So that's what I call as an MVP loop. You start with an hypothesis, two hypotheses actually. One, that there is a problem that needs to be solved, or there is an opportunity which can be served. Your second hypothesis is the solution you have is the right solution. And you need to check those two first and then go ahead and do something. So what do? You have an hypothesis, you design an experiment to check those hypotheses. Now what could be those experiments? It could be as simple as a questionnaire or an interview, or you can create explainer videos. Dropbox is the best example of that. You can have your HTML prototypes. You can have paper prototypes. Or you can go with more delicate things like concierge approach or Wizard of Oz approach. Zappos did the Wizard of Oz approach. Zappos is the biggest online shoe retailer. So based on those experiments, you run those experiments, you get some measures, some information. Use those measures to check your hypothesis. And if those hypotheses need to be modified, do that. Run the experiments again. Keep this loop going till you have enough information to start developing your product. That's what I call this loop. You start with the first hypothesis, you do first round of experimentation, learn from it, do the second round. Keep doing it till you have enough information to say that this is what my customers or users want, and this is the solution to solve their problem. And that's when you release your first product. Normally, these days, we call this first release as MVP. But I like to call it as MMP, minimum marketable product, or minimum releasable product, or yeah, most popularly called as minimum viable product. So instead of going directly coding, getting things out, please try, first check your hypothesis, design experiments to solve those problems, and then go and out. What you're trying to do is just trying to reduce the risk of a failure. It will not make risk zero, but it will reduce it a lot. Thank you. Yeah. I'm not saying trial sprint. So what I was talking about is not involves any coding, any database. A questionnaire, it's a paper questionnaire. You can go ask questions to your users, or you can interview your users. An explainer video, you just create a video showing what you want to do. Give it on a Facebook or anywhere else. Any other question? I think I still have 38, 35 seconds. Thank you.
All right, thank you for coming. And like I said, 1:30, we'll do four of these again. If you are interested in listening from people who are attending, please do come back. And please do present too, like that is a good option. It is first come, first served.